I am transgender. Growing up, it was scary. I didn't have anyone to talk to. My family didn't understand. It's a struggle to be real. Society, for some reason, doesn't want people to be real. I've come across a lot of transgender children in the world, and I want to do everything in my power to make sure that they don't go through the things that I went through. It doesn't matter what gender you are. It doesn't matter what you look like. It just matters, are you a good person? I want someone to know it's okay to be transgender. It's okay to discover that you're not transgender if you think you are. It's okay to be gender fluid. It's okay to be gender neutral. It's okay to be gender non-conforming. It's okay to be male. It's okay to be female. It's okay to be gay, straight, lesbian. It's okay. Just please be a good person. Be kind. My ex-wife and I are now very good friends. One of the greatest gifts that she gave me, and I truly consider it a gift, is the introduction to that sport right there, disc golf. Disc golf came into my life at just the right time. Like I said, I had quit sports. I was no longer an athlete. I was doing lots of bad things, lots of bad behaviors, lots of bad drugs, and this sport came into my world. It's a very simple sport to play. All you have to do is pick up a frisbee, go find a course that is near you, and start playing the game. It is played exactly like regular golf. You've got a disc instead of a golf club. You've got a basket instead of a hole in the ground. You've got a tee box that you throw the disc from. This is your target, and instead of playing in 300-yard, 400-yard, 500-yard holes, you're playing 300 feet, 400 feet, 500 feet holes. Just like regular golf, you've got drivers, you've got putters, you've got mid-ranges, and you have tons of challenging shots to make. Baseball is easy compared to this sport right here. I have never mastered this sport, and every time I think I do have it mastered, reality sets in that I have a long ways to go. It offers me three things that I find so valuable to my life. I love watching things fly. That's the athlete in me. I love nature, thanks to my grandmother. And I love the community of disc golfers. If it wasn't for the fact of the community of disc golfers that I have in my life, I would not be sitting here right now talking to you. It is a disc golfer that hooked me up on this, and I'm forever thankful for my disc golf community. The game of disc golf is kind of like a mind game. Like I said, really, all it takes is a couple of frisbees. More than that. The frisbees, they have different designs, they come in different colors, but there's one thing about them all that are regular and normal. You can't play catch with these. They're hard as a rock. You'll break your fingers with them. These are not the frisbees that you play with in your backyard. These take athleticism to throw. These take coordination, and they take skill. And these things can be thrown a long ways. I was talking about the difference between a putter and a driver. You can see the thickness difference. This is a putter here, just like in regular golf, you've got a putter, and this is to be used to finish the hole. As you get closer to the target, you throw the frisbee in the hole, winner, winner, chicken dinner, you do the dance and everything like that, and you go on to the next hole. The drivers, the ones that you throw off of the tee box, they're just like in regular golf. Everybody loves smashing the long drive. Everybody likes to stand back and go, look how far I just hit that, or look how far I just threw that. There are people that can throw these discs 500 feet. There are people that can throw these discs like a baseball. They can throw them sidearm like some kind of crazy pitcher from the old days. There's all kinds of different ways you can throw these things. Me personally, I can throw the thing about 270, 280 feet, which is fine. It gets me through all of the courses around here, and it's so much fun. I truly, truly, truly recommend that anybody that is looking for a new sport to play to try this one out. There's a lovely sound it makes when the disc hits the basket. Music. I'm always hoping to hear that sound, and I hope to one day see you on the disc golf course where you will come play this sport with me, because I'm telling you, it truly is a wonderful community of people that will become your family. Disc golf, though, is also one of those sports that in the 90s, when I discovered the sport, I also started discovering myself. I would go out onto the disc golf course, and just like when I was in high school baseball, I would go out wearing makeup or nail polish or a female shirt, something to start letting the real person in me to come out. The community wasn't as accepting back then as they are now. Now, I'm assuming that everybody knows that I'm a transgender disc golfer. I don't care that they think of me that way. A lot of people don't want to be think of transgendered that are. That is fine. A lot of people are still stealth. Once they transition, they don't tell the world, and that is fine too, because I did that for a long time as well. But, like so many other transgendered people, the first time I attempted to transition, I did not finish and follow it through. I started to transition in 96 for the first time. I had done lots of electrolysis, and electrolysis is basically where some person with a very sharp needle sticks that needle into a hair follicle, wires and contraptions running down to the ground, and they step on this little button, and then you get zorned right in the lip. And man, does it hurt. There is nothing pleasant about it. It is straight up, you're being electrocuted. But this is what the technology was at the time. And I would religiously go to this. Twice a week, I would go to electrolysis. I would come back and my face would be all red and swollen, and it was obvious that something was going on with me. At that same time, I started hormones. So for about 7 months, I was still pretending to be male, started the hormones, and my breasts started developing. Now you would think, being transgendered and desperately wanting to be who I am my entire life, that once my breasts started developing, I would jump for joy. Instead, I freaked out, completely just freaked out. People started noticing that I had breasts, so I was at that point where I'm going to have to do something. I'm either going to have to continue down the path, or I'm going to have to stop, regroup, and come back. So I quit transition, just stopped. Stopped the hormones, stopped the electrolysis, stopped everything. Because you see, once again, that societal pressure, that family pressure was bearing down on me. My family had upped the ante on what was going to happen if I transitioned. There was no longer, we're going to pray for you, we're going to send you to conversion therapy. We had moved past that. It was to the point now that when I transitioned, they were going to disown me and I would never be a part of the family again. And I was not ready. I was not ready at all to lose my family, which is a sad thing to do. Your family shouldn't put you in a place to where you have to decide between being real and being with your family. But there I was stuck at that point. I was in my mid-20s to near 30 years old, and I was not ready to be alone. I didn't have the coping skills. I mean, my coping skill at this point had been drugs, and then disc golf was introduced to my life, and disc golf became my coping skill. Well, like I said, the people in disc golf weren't that accepting at the time. So I quit sports again. Just stopped. During this time, I had met and made a whole set of friends through disc golf, a whole set of friends through being the manly man that I had pretended to be previous to meeting my wife. And sadly, a lot of us were in the same boat of being untrue to ourselves. We were all searching for different things, for different ways, but we were all searching. We were all lost. We were all trying to figure out what was going on in life, and we were all going about it the wrong way. Being the avid male enthusiast hunter that I was at the time, because I mean, that's the thing about being transgender. There was times as you're bouncing around trying to figure out who you are, you're hyper feminine, you're hyper masculine, you're both feminine and masculine, you're neither feminine nor masculine. Everything is going on as you're trying to bounce around and figure out where you fit in with society and where you fit in with your real self. Well, during that time of being the avid outdoorsman, I bought a rifle. I started getting concerned about having a rifle around me. I started not having safe thoughts. I started having thoughts of hurting myself with that rifle. So I thought that I was doing the right thing. And I gave that rifle to a friend of mine. I just thought, you know, I don't need this rifle. I'm going to kill myself. My friend, a month later, took that very same rifle and killed himself with it. I really wished I had given him that rifle. I know it is not my fault that he committed suicide. I know that was his own demons that he was battling with and he had given up. But damn, I wished I hadn't given him that rifle. That's one thing I didn't need to deal with. After that happened, I really became alone. People were abandoning me left and right because I was trying to transition. I was trying to not transition. I'd given a rifle to somebody that committed suicide with it. I was lost. So I went back to battling my true self, and I went deeper into being a man. Once again, outdoors all the way. Bought the four-wheel drive truck, bought the ATVs, just anything I could think of that I thought a man would want. And I would go at it. The whole time I was there, I knew it was fake. I knew that this was not who I was, but I was scared. I was afraid of myself. I was afraid of losing my family. I was afraid of being afraid. I don't know, I was just afraid. I was still battling internally, still battling internally. During the time of my first marriage, I went back to college. College was so hard for me that I took a weightlifting class and failed it because I didn't want to put muscle mass on. I signed up for the class at the time thinking, you know, I'll go pump iron, I'll get ripped, I'll do everything, send the testosterone just oozing through my body, and that would make me become a man. I knew that that wasn't going to happen, and after the first class, I just quit going. I didn't drop out of the class. I didn't do anything. I just quit going. So I failed weightlifting. But during that time, I did get to go back to my love of nature. Thank you, Grandmother, for that. I got a degree. I actually finished college. It took me 9 years. It took me lots of delivering of pizzas to people's houses and lots of long nights, but I did it. I got my degree in forestry. Can't get much more manly than that. So from 1992 until 1995, I went to work for the state of Tennessee as an area forester. I threw myself into that job 100%. Wore the park ranger uniform, had the badge on, had the radio on the side, had the cool ranger hat. I was it. I was an area forester. I was a man. I was actually in charge of a state forest. I was also in charge of 3 counties worth of public land, and I was in charge of all the firefighters that we had on that were there in those 3 counties. Because you see, in East Tennessee, a lot of times things happen that make people do unwise things. A lot of times in Tennessee, if you're mad at your neighbor and there's forest land, the way you get even with them, you just burn their land. We had lots of forest fires in those 3 counties, and I would always go out and fight forest fires. That's what it's like to be a man, I thought. Hoof it out into the middle of nowhere, get your rake, and start digging trenches around a fire you'll never see. I was living in a small town, a town that I don't know what would have happened had they known the real Kelly Jenkins at that time. I remember going into that job, and one of the first things my secretary told me was, "You'll like it living here. There's only one black family in the entire community, and they live way up on the mountain away from each other. You'll never see them." Lord, if you can't accept a black person, how in the heck are you going to accept a transgendered woman? It doesn't matter if I'm white or not. It didn't matter that I was presenting as male. It didn't matter that I was burly at the time. There was female all over me. I couldn't hide it. You can't hide the real you. You just can't. You can pretend to hide the real you, and some people are good at it for a long, long time, but you can't hide the real you. After that job, I started getting jobs in environmental education camps. Another what I thought was a manly job. But what I didn't realize was that the hormones that I had taken back in 96 had done some permanent things to me. That it had softened my skin, it had actually gave me a little bit of breast, and it changed, I don't want to say aura, it changed my the way I came across the people. And at an environmental education camps, working with children, children see things. And I would get children asking me, even when I was this burly, what I thought was burly man, they would ask me, "Are you a man or a woman?" I never would get to answer that question because one of my teammates, one of my coworkers, would always jump in and say, "Oh, he's a man. Just because he has earrings doesn't mean he's a woman." No, the kids saw the truth. They're good at that. They're good at seeing the truth. Transgendered kids, a lot of them know that they are transgendered. Listen to them. Other kids, they're battling with it. They don't know if they're gender fluid. They don't know if they're gender nonconforming. They don't know if they're gender neutral. They don't know, so they're searching. Parents, go on a search with those kids. Be a part of that journey. Don't pull yourself away from them and hope that by ignoring it, that your kid is going to discover the answer on their own. I did discover the answer on my own. But there's a lot of us that don't. The suicide attempt rate is staggering in the transgender community. near as they can tell, over 40% of us attempt to commit suicide, attempt to kill ourselves. That's shameful. If any other part of the population of the world, if 40% of that population was trying to kill itself, action would be taken. Things would happen. But for some reason, in our society, it feels like that 40% suicide attempt rate is acceptable. It's not. That's why I'm sitting here now, to let you know that there are kids out there, there are adults out there that are struggling, not just with being transgendered, just with being real, with finding who they are. And as a society, we're supposed to love people. We're supposed to help people discover who they are. We're supposed to want that from them, because when people become themselves, they become productive. And a lot of transgendered people are not productive members of society, because a lot of times we're not accepted. In environmental education camps, I was accepted as a male, a bit effeminate male, but I was accepted as a male. Another thing that happened to me while I was working at those environmental education camps, I met my second wife. The first time I met her, she walked up to me and I didn't understand a word she said. Not the first word she said, because she was from Yorkshire in England. And talk about a thick accent. The southern accent is thick. A Yorkie accent, that's a whole nother level of thick. It took me a long time to actually be able to understand what she was saying. I never did understand what she was saying. I understood the words, but her and I never communicated with each other, hardly, on real levels. She knew that I wanted to be a woman also. That's the one thing I can say about both of my marriages. I gave them the heads up ahead of time. We don't know what that means. She didn't know what it meant. My first wife didn't know what it meant. I didn't know when I was going to transgender or transition. I just knew I was going to do it. She didn't care. So, in the year 2000, I moved to England with her. Whole new chapter of my life. Everything's going to be great again. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I've met a woman and I am going to be a man. I'm going to move across an ocean to be a man. 12 months later, we're separated. I'm living on my own in England with no wife. But something crazy happened again. Inspiration hit me. And while I was there, I went back to college for a second time, and I actually got a teaching license. That teaching license has been a blessing to me, but you know, it has also been a curse, because as good a teacher as I am, as much as I want to be around children, as hard as I've trained for it, there was always this part of the population in the school system that were not comfortable with me. And I would lose my jobs a lot. A lot. While I was in England, that last year after my marriage had failed, after I'd finally got a teaching license to do what I thought was going to be my passion, I rediscovered myself. And I rededicated myself to transitioning. I transitioned in a big way. So when I moved back from England, two of the things that I brought with me were a teaching license, and I rededicated myself 100% to my transition. This time it was all or nothing. Either I was going to transition and get it done right, or I was going to be a lost soul for the rest of my life and was not going to be happy. So I chose the option of rededicating my life to transition. I can't believe anybody chooses to be unhappy. I'm assuming that most people in life want to be happy. And I had to do it. Society was sitting there telling me, no, you've got to be unhappy. Well, they weren't saying I had to be unhappy. They said that I had to believe that there were two genders, and I was a male. I've given up on that thought. I knew I wasn't a male. I wasn't going to push that envelope anymore. I wasn't going to challenge it. I knew that I was a woman, and I brought that back, and I brought that determination back with me from England. So when I moved back, I started electrolysis again, and for over 2 years, twice a week, I did electrolysis. $60 an hour, $120 a week for 2 years. Best money I ever spent. Flat broke now, don't have a nickel to rub against my jeans or anything, but I'm real. I also started hormones then, and this time, when my breast started developing, a different feeling happened. Happiness, joy, relief, freedom, the ability to be real. All of the adjectives you can think of that will help you to be you. I also came back and found a job in a middle school with my newfound teaching license. It wasn't a teaching position, but it was working in an alternative education classroom. So during that year, I had the ability to stay stealth, still present as a man. Electrolysis was happening regularly. Hormones were going on, and I was able to still pretend to be a man, but I knew what the end game was going to be, so I was okay with it. At the end of that school year, my aunt, who was a lifelong teacher, just like it seems like everybody in my family is, found me a job in Knox County Schools in Tennessee as a middle school teacher at Northwest Middle School. I thought that I'd had it made. Here was a good teaching job. Here was the chance for me to show the world that I was a fantastic teacher. And here was a chance for me to make money, because money is not a bad thing when you are transitioning. As a matter of fact, you can't transition without money. That's one of the things about it. A lot of insurance companies do not help people that are transitioning. We scrape by, we save money, we work jobs, we do whatever it takes to transition. You have to. You're at this point in your life where, what are you going to do? You can't hide anymore. So I went after it. This job at the school that my aunt found for me, I was an eighth grade science teacher, and I loved it. I saw kids from every background imaginable. I saw children that were poor, I saw children that were rich, I saw children that were black, white, Asian, European, you name it. There were kids from everywhere in this school, and I got something that I needed from society. A different view of culture, a different view of the world, and I relished it. I loved the fact that these children were unique, that they were attempting to be real at their age. I mean, what greater gift can a person have, like I said, than to be real?